Hi, today's lecture is on orthognathic surgery. This is a purely a specialty topic. Only if you are a oral and maxillofacial surgeon, you will be able to perform this procedure. And as an undergraduate, you are expected to know what orthognathic surgery is all about. And I'm sure you must be aware of the various facial deformities like prognathism, retrognathism, vertical maxillary excess, etc. So basically we expect you to have the knowledge so that you will be able to identify a facial deformity when you encounter one. And orthognathic surgery is basically surgery is performed in the jaws, the maxilla and the mandible to correct the deformity. So you should be aware of the various surgical procedures that are involved in orthognathic surgery, and you should also be able to explain it to the patient, like how the surgery is going to be performed, and you should be aware of the various complications that you can encounter during the procedure or post-operatively. So coming to the learning outcomes, you should have the knowledge to select cases when surgical treatment is likely to be necessary in addition to orthodontic treatment, and you should also know the appropriate orthognathic surgical technique that is required for that particular patient, and you should be able to explain to the patient about the osteotomy procedure, including the indications, management risks and complications. So what is orthognathic surgery? By definition, it is the art and science of diagnosis, treatment planning and execution of treatment by combining orthodontics and oral and maxillofacial surgery to correct musculoskeletal, dento-osseous and soft tissue deformities of the jaws and associated structures. So basically it's refers to the alignment of the jaws, and it includes surgical repositioning of the jaws and or the dento-alveolar structures. This option is preserved for the correction of severe skeletal discrepancy after growth has ceased. So basically the orthognathic surgery is performed after the growth has ceased. In very rare cases, it is done in patients who are still in the growing phase. Hence, the aim of an orthognathic surgery is to normalize the relationship of the jaws with themselves and to the rest of the craniofacial complex. So just to brush up your knowledge which you must have gained in orthodontics last year. So we are going to have a classification of dentofacial deformity. So when it comes to mandible, when there is excess of mandibular growth, it is called as mandibular prognathism, and when there is a deficient growth, then it is called as mandibular retrognathism. And when the deformity is restricted to the chin instead of the entire bone, it's just restricted to the chin. When it is in excess, it's called as macrogenia, and when there is a deficient chin deformity, it is called as microgenia. Coming to maxilla, so excess, that is, there is you have vertical maxillary excess and anterior posterior excess depending upon the dimension. Vertically, if there is excessive growth, it is called as vertical maxillary excess, and anterior posteriorly, if the maxilla is protruding out, it is called as anterior posterior excess. And deficiency, again you have vertical maxillary deficiency, anterior posterior deficiency, and also you have another concept which is the transverse deficiency, as you see in alveolar clefts. And when both mandible and the maxilla are involved, it is, can be a bimaxillary protrusion, can be a nasomaxillary hypoplasia associated with prognathic mandible, or nasomaxillary hypoplasia associated with cleft lip cases. And you also have a range of facial asymmetry. You have asymmetric prognathism of the mandible, unilateral condylar hyperplasia, hemifacial hypertrophy and hemifacial microsomia. So just going to see certain prominent clinical features of various jaw deformities. So we'll start off with mandibular prognathism. When you observe the facial features, you will notice a prominent chin which is seen in the lower third of the face, and the profile, the facial profile will be concave, and there will be incompetency of the lips. There will be a steep mandibular plane, obtuse gonial angle, middle third will be deficient, the labiomental fold will be diminished, and the nasolabial angle will be acute, and the anterior facial height is increased. So coming to the dental features, you will be having an angles class 3 malocclusion with a reverse horizontal overjet, posterior crossbite can be seen, and mandibular anteriors may be lingually inclined and the maxillary anteriors will be proclined. This is called as dental compensation. To compensate the deformity in the jaw, the dentition arranges itself so that the deformity doesn't look very prominent. So in a patient with a prognathic mandible, you can see the mandibular anterior teeth will be lingually inclined and the maxillary anteriors may be proclined. So this is called as dental compensation. And patient will also have anterior open bite. Coming to mandibular deficiency, which is also called as retrognathism or micrognathism, when you observe the facial features, you will notice that the patient has a convex profile with a retruded chin. It's called as bird face deformity in severe cases. And there will be a short upper lip, averted lower lip, curled under upper protruded incisors, a deep mentolabial fold, and acute gonial angle will be present. And coming to the dental features, you will have angles class 2 malocclusion with an increased overjet, fanning or tipped forward of the forwarding of the lower anteriors, and deep bite will also be seen. So that's the case. You can see the pictures. Those are two patients with a mandibular prognathism and a mandibular retrognathism. Coming to the maxilla, you have a condition called as a vertical maxillary excess, where there will be increased height of the lower third of the face, narrow alar base with recessive paranasal areas, prominent infraorbital rims with the and cheekbones and the nose, a large interlabial gap more than 4 mm with incompetent lips and gummy smile, recessive chin with a steep mandibular plane, class 2 malocclusion, patient will have a V-shaped arch and high arched palate, and there will be anterior open bite. It might be there or no, it might not be there. Coming to vertical maxillary deficiency, the patient will have a short square shaped face with a decreased lower facial height, and mandible will be square and quite prominent due to the overclosure. Deep mentolabial fold, knobby appearance of the chin, overclosure of the lips, class 1 or class 2 malocclusion, deep overbite, mandibular incisors occlude with the palatal gingiva, and severe attrition may be seen. So those are two pictures with the patient with a vertical maxillary excess and vertical maxillary deficiency. So, coming to the orthognathic surgery, now you have a patient with a prominent facial deformity. So, how are you going to plan the treatment? So, first is the initial assessment. Okay, so you record the chief complaint of the patient, the usual medical and dental history, and then you go for the clinical examination where you have to check the facial proportions and the facial profile. So, there are certain things which you need to examine and confirm when it comes to recording the facial proportions and facial profile. And then you make an impression and make a dental study model which you need to evaluate. And then cephalometric analysis is done where the retrognathism or prognathism or vertical maxillary excess, whatever it is assessed. And a mock surgery or a model surgery is performed on the study model, followed by a definitive surgical plan. So what is the sequence of the treatment planning? First, you need to do some dental and periodontal treatment, scaling, oral prophylaxis, if there is some dental caries or something that has to be restored, and if there is some grossly decayed teeth, maybe you need to extract it out. And pre-surgical orthodontics is a procedure which is sometimes might be required, especially when the patient has dental compensation. So basically, the teeth which is inclined lingually or proclined labially, it needs to be corrected. So that is done during the pre-surgical orthodontist. And then it is followed by the proper orthognathic surgery. And post-surgical orthodontics might be required in certain cases, and followed by definitive dental management. And later, you might have to do certain adjunctive aesthetic surgery like rhinoplasty. So what are the objectives of pre-surgical orthodontics? you need to relieve arch crowding. If there is a crowded dentition, the crowding has to be corrected. It has to be relieved. If there is spacing between the teeth, spacing in the dentition, the spaces have to be closed. And if there is some tooth which is rotated, that has to be corrected. And the tooth alignment with the arches has to be properly maintained. And you will have to control relapse tendencies, remove gross occlusal interferences, positioning the teeth in an ideal relationship to their respective dental bases, dental restrictions imposed on surgical correction of jaws are eliminated, and pre-surgical orthodontics allows maximum surgical correction. You need to correct all the dental anomalies before taking up the case for the proper orthognathic surgery so that the surgical correction will be optimal. And it also allows proper intraoperative control and proper postoperative stabilization. So normally a pre-surgical orthodontic treatment will last for say from around 3 to 12 months. It is pretty variable. And post-surgical orthodontics again can be for a period of around 3 to 6 months. So what are the various osteotomy procedures? So when you say orthognathic surgery, basically you are cutting the bone. So that is called as an osteotomy. So we call it as osteotomy procedure. So the various osteotomy procedures done in mandible. So depending upon the area where you are performing the osteotomy, like you know that mandible has a body, it has a ramus, and the chin portion, that is where it's called as a, you remember microgenia and macrogenia. So when surgery can be performed in the chin region. So when it comes to the osteotomy procedures done in the body, mandibular body osteotomies, you have something called as anterior body osteotomy and posterior body osteotomy, and then you have symphysis osteotomies. And then another procedure which is called as subapical mandibular surgeries, where the dentoalveolar segment is cut and repositioned. It is osteotomized and repositioned, and the cut below the cut is made in the bone below the apex of the teeth. So this is called as subapical mandibular surgeries, and it is done segmentally. So it is segmental subapical mandibular surgery. If it is performed in the anterior part of the mandible, it is called as anterior subapical mandibular osteotomy. And similarly, you have a posterior subapical mandibular osteotomy. If the entire dentoalveolar segment is osteotomized and repositioned, it is called as a total subapical mandibular osteotomy. Then you have a procedure called as genioplasties. So you have augmentation genioplasty, reduction genioplasty. So if a patient has a microgenia, okay, a deficiency in the chin, then augmentation genioplasty is performed. And if it is a macrogenia, reduction genioplasty is performed. And if there is some kind of asymmetry, then you have to perform straightening genioplasty and lengthening genioplasty. You have another few procedures which is performed in the ramus of the mandible, and the most commonly performed procedure and which is quite popular also, this is called as a sagittal split osteotomy. It is done both sides, both on the right side and the left side, so it will be called as bilateral sagittal split osteotomy, and short BSSO. And then you have extraoral vertical subsigmoid osteotomy, intraoral vertical subsigmoid osteotomy, inverted L osteotomy, arching ramus osteotomy, and C osteotomies. All these osteotomies are performed in the ramus of the mandible. You will be seeing pictures of these osteotomies in the forthcoming slide, so you will be able to understand better. So we'll start off with genioplasty. So what do you, as I said earlier, it is a method to correct chin prominence and contour. Okay, so you have normally genioplasty can be just a simple reduction or recontouring by bone sculpture, or it can be a augmentation by bone onlays or the addition of alloplastic materials. And you have another also various forms of sliding osteotomy of the lower border. So what is reduction genioplasty, where you are reducing the prominence of the chin? So it can be either vertical or horizontal reduction genioplasty. Basically what we do is we remove a wedge of bone below the apex of the teeth. So you're removing a wedge of bone subapically and reposition the lower border superiorly. And this is fixed with simple wires, or you can use a plate. So the cut surfaces are fixed either using a transosseous wiring or using plates and screws. So soft tissues are not detached. Okay, so basically you are dealing only with the bone, so that soft tissues are not detached on the lingual side. So the labial side will make the incision, reflect the flap, expose the inferior border of the mandible, and reduction process is done using osteotomy. And the lingual side, the soft tissues are maintained intact. So that is to maintain the viability and to improve the post-operative contour. Augmentation genioplasty is where you correct microgenia, where there is a deficient gene. So it can be advancement or anterior augmentation genioplasty or a vertical augmentation genioplasty, depending upon the plane in where the plane in which you are achieving the augmentation. So the oblique cut is now made below the apices of the anterior teeth and carrying it to the lower border below the mental foramina. The anterior lower border is angled down and bone or proplast, an alloplastic material, is inserted to make up the required increase in the vertical height. So those are the various genioplasty procedures. You can see a wedge of bone is removed subapically and the osteotomized segment is repositioned. So this is a reduction genioplasty, that is the third picture. Okay, so various reduction genioplasties, you can see augmentation genioplasties, etc. So this is a picture which depicts the genioplasty with graft interposition. So in the picture B, you can see a shaded block between the osteotomized segments. So that is the proplastic material or a piece of bone which can be used to augment the chin. So here again, augmentation genioplasty, where it is positioned with a screw. So what are the complications of genioplasty? So as I said earlier, the osteotomized cut should go below the mental foramen. So if you're not careful, the mental nerve will be injured, leading to paresthesia. Chin ptosis. So when you do the final closure, if you're not careful, the mentalis muscle will sag, which will lead to chin ptosis, which is also known as witch's chin. And especially in augmentation genioplasty, sometimes it might result in lower lip incompetence. And when you place the graft, of course, there is always the complication of resorption of the graft. And sometimes there will be relapse and periodontal defects. So coming to the Raymer's osteotomy, we have sagittal split osteotomy, vertical subsigmoid osteotomy, inverted L osteotomy, C osteotomy, and oblique subcondylar osteotomy. So what is sagittal split osteotomy? It has a colorful history. First, it was introduced by Trauner and Obwegizer, two pioneers in maxillofacial surgery. Later, it was modified by Dalpont and Hansen. Basically, sagittal split osteotomy is the natural plane of cleavage between the buccal and lingual cortical plates of the ramus is used to develop a sagittal split, separating the proximal fragment, that is the fragment which involves the condyle, from the distal fragment, which is the dentoalveolar fragment. Okay, so basically the buccal and cortical plates of the mandible, they are split sagittally. Okay, so once you have done the osteotomy and you have split it, you will have two fragments. You have a proximal fragment and a distal fragment. Proximal fragment is that fragment which has the condyle and which is still attached to the cranium. And the distal fragment is the fragment which has the dentoalveolar component. So the distal fragment can be either moved anteriorly or posteriorly. Okay, and that will be used to correct the defect. So that is the principle of sagittal split osteotomy. If you see the picture, you will be able to understand better. So you can see there the cut is made. Okay, you have a vertical cut and a horizontal cut which is made below the mental foramen, and above the mandibular foramen. And the proximal fragment is that fragment which has the condyle, and the distal fragment is the fragment which has the teeth and the alveolar bone. Okay, so the distal fragment can be moved to and fro. Okay, so that's how you mobilize the fragments and correct the facial deformity. So the cut is made in such a way that the buccal and cortical plates are split vertically, that's sagittally. Okay, so that's how you perform a bilateral sagittal split osteotomy to correct a retrognathic mandible. So you can see the picture where the mandible has been advanced. So this is called as bilateral sagittal split osteotomy with advancement. Then you have sagittal split osteotomy bilateral with where you are correcting a prognathic mandible. So you can see there the mandible has been pushed back. So this is called as sagittal split osteotomy for setback. And then this is a picture which is showing an inverted L ramus osteotomy, and it has been done for advancement. And various ramus osteotomies for advancement. The first picture is the sagittal split osteotomy. Then you have inverted L osteotomy, vertical subsigmoid osteotomy, C osteotomy, and arching osteotomy. So these are the various ramus osteotomies for setback. You have the condylotomy, subcondylar osteotomy, obvigizer sagittal split osteotomy, vertical subsigmoid osteotomy, inverted L osteotomy. So remember about the subapical osteotomy. So you can see there the cuts are made. The osteotomy is done in such a way that the fragment of a bone involving the teeth and the alveolar bone is separated. Okay, so this is called as a subapical osteotomy. Okay, now we come to the maxillary osteotomy procedures. Now, when it comes to maxilla, you have segmental procedures and procedures involving the entire maxilla. Segmental procedures are those procedures where the surgery is performed in just a segment of the mandible. Just a small part of the mandible is cut and mobilized. So they are called as segmental procedures, and they are the single tooth dentosseous osteotomy, interdental osteotomy, and then you have the most famous anterior maxillary osteotomy, also called as AMO, and posterior maxillary osteotomy. Then you have procedures involving the entire maxilla. They are called as Lifford procedures. So what do we do here? This name Lifford might sound familiar to you. Yes, it's the same Lifford where we have studied about fractures, middle third fractures. You have a classification, Lifford classification. So what happens there? The fracture line follows a pattern. Okay, when a middle third bone, middle third of the facial bone is subjected to trauma, the fracture happens in a particular pattern, and based upon the pattern they have classified it as Lifford 1, Lifford 2, and Lifford 3. Okay, so now if you make a osteotomy, if you cut the maxilla according to the Lifford fracture line, for example, if you do a make a osteotomy cut following the Lifford 1 fracture, okay, you know how a Lifford 1 fracture is, from the floor of the nose involving the floor of the maxillary sinus, going posteriorly involving the maxillary tuberosity and fracturing the pterygoid plates. Okay, so if you make a osteotomy cut according to the Lifford fracture line, then it is called as Lifford 1 osteotomy. So these are called as Lifford procedures, and these Lifford procedures, again like Lifford 1, 2, 3, you have Lifford 1, 2, and 3 osteotomies. And using these osteotomies, you can do superior repositioning of the maxilla, inferior repositioning of the maxilla. Superior repositioning is for vertical maxillary excess. Inferior repositioning is for vertical maxillary deficiency. And you can do something known as horseshoe shaped osteotomy. Advancement of maxilla can be done in retrognathic maxilla. And leveling of the maxilla for facial asymmetries. So that is called as a differential osteotomy, Lifford osteotomy. So now this picture, this is a picture which shows anterior maxillary osteotomy. So you can see there a premolar has been removed, okay, and the bone as wide as the premolars, as wide as the mesiodistal width of the premolar. That much of bone is osteotomized and removed, okay, and then the anterior maxillary segment is mobilized, down fractured, and it is pushed depending upon the indication. If it is a vertical maxillary excess, you need to superiorly reposition it. A prognathic maxilla, it has to be pushed back. If it is a retrognathic maxilla, anterior posterior deficiency of the maxilla, then it is brought forward, and later it can be stabilized using a plate or transosseous wiring. So if the same segmental osteotomy is performed in the posterior aspect of the maxilla, it is called as posterior segmental osteotomy. And then you have the Lefort 1 osteotomy, where I told you like the fracture, like the osteotomy follows the Lefort 1 fracture line. So the entire maxilla is cut, okay, and using some specialized instruments like pterygoid chisel, etc., you fracture the entire maxilla, and then the entire maxilla is mobilized and it is repositioned as per the indication, okay. Superior repositioning, inferior repositioning, anterior repositioning, etc., advancement or setting it back, whatever it is. Then you have Lefort 2 osteotomy, similar to the Lefort 2 fracture line. And the last part, the Lefort 3 osteotomy, where the entire facial skeleton is mobilized, just like it's called as craniofacial disjunction. It is totally mobilized and repositioned. And this Lefort 3 osteotomy is normally performed in very severe facial deformity cases in certain syndromes, etc. So that is the Rose disimpaction forces, which we normally use to down fracture the maxilla or the middle third, like during the orthognathic surgery. This forceps, disimpaction forceps, is also used in trauma management, and it is another integral part of the osteotomy procedures performed in maxilla. So that's where you see the entire middle third is, the middle third of the face is disjunction from the cranium. That is Lefort 3 osteotomy. Okay, now we come to the complications of orthognathic surgery. You have certain intraoperative complications, that is complications that can happen during the procedure, during the surgical procedure. For performing an orthognathic surgery, the surgeon has to be skilled and he should be well trained, and it has a very delicate kind of procedure, okay, and it has to be done with a lot of care, and the surgeon has to be very meticulous. He shouldn't rush through the procedure, and all this osteotomy has to be done in a proper manner. If you are not careful, it can result in an unfavorable osteotomy, and you are dealing with a lot of vessels, okay, especially in a Lefort 1 osteotomy, when you are finally using a pterygoid chisel to fracture the pterygoid plate. If you are not careful, the chisel will slip and it can damage the internal maxillary heart artery, which can result in severe hemorrhage, okay, which can even be fatal. So have to be very careful when you are performing this procedure, because hemorrhage is one of the complications and it has to be properly managed and controlled. And difficult positioning and fixation, okay, so when you are doing a procedure, then you might encounter certain difficulty in the positioning of the jawbone, either the maxilla or the mandible, and in the fixation. Nasal and airway problems. This is basically normally encountered when you are superiorly repositioning the maxilla. Okay, when you are superiorly repositioning the maxilla or when you are setting it back, you will compromise on the airway. When you are superiorly repositioning the maxilla, the nasal airway will get restricted. Okay, because you are introducing the maxilla slightly up, so there you can compromise the aperture, nasal aperture, the piriform aperture, which can lead to difficulty in the breathing. Okay, even when you are setting it back again, you will be compromising the nasopharynx and the oropharynx, so again the airway problem results. So most of the time after this procedure, patients will be having obstructive sleep apnea. And when you are performing a subapical osteotomy, okay, if you are not careful, you might injure the apical blood supply. Normally the osteotomy cut is 2 to 3 mm below the apex of the teeth. If you are not careful, you might compromise on the subapical blood supply of the teeth, resulting in loss of vitality of the teeth. And post-operative complications, relapse. Okay, you position the osteotomized segment and you stabilize it with plates and screws, but still it can result in relapse. Maxillary settling after a superior repositioning of the maxilla. Transverse relapse can also occur. Condylar distraction, especially when you are doing an advancement of the mandible. And bleeding, again post-operatively also it can occur. Avascular necrosis, this is another complication which can happen if you are not careful, because you are cutting the bone, okay, and you are moving it, and always you should maintain the blood supply. You should be very careful that there is adequate blood supply to the bone, the osteotomized segment of the bone, so that the vitality is maintained. If the blood supply is compromised, it can result in avascular necrosis. Periodontal defects can also occur. Nerve injury, especially the mental nerve or the inferior alveolar nerve as when it's entering the mandibular foramen. Infection postoperatively can happen. And non-union, if your fixation is not rigid, this can result in non-union. So the osteotomized segment doesn't unite and it can result in mobility of the osteotomized fragments. So now you see a patient who's got a anterior posterior deficiency of the maxilla and prognathic mandible. So maxillary advancement has been performed. Lifot 1 osteotomy with advancement of the maxilla has been performed. And the mandible has been set back using bilateral sagittal split osteotomy. And you can see the postoperative results. Okay. So that brings us to the end. If you have any doubts or questions, please post them on the e-portal. I'll be more than happy to answer them. Thank you.